What is good, everybody? This is Eye Test Takes, the podcast with your host, Logan Hill. We're back again with another episode. This is going to be recapping week four. And you know who else is back? My Eagles, baby. Let's go. Never had a doubt. First in the division. I'm just kidding. They still were pretty iffy. They kind of struggled. I'm going to go ahead and get it right into that game. I just kind of want to cover that because that was obviously the first game I watched because I ended up watching the other two Monday Night Football games as the three games I watched this week. So I'll get into that later. But just to step right into the Eagles versus San Francisco on Sunday Night Football, it was a very ugly game. Nick Mullins obviously gets the start for San Fran, and the Eagles come after him early and often. That D-line was dominant against the San Francisco O-line. They didn't really have an answer for them there. Nick Mullins still moved the ball pretty decently, which is not a great sign necessarily for my Eagles defense. But at the end of the day, the Eagles were able to get the job done. They realistically, Carson Wentz was able to make a play here and there, and it was enough to beat the 49ers. So it was still ugly. Somehow, like I said, the Eagles are winning the division still. I don't know how that happens, mostly because Dallas's defense is competing to be the worst in all of football with the Falcons defense, who I will also get to later. Man, it's just crazy the Eagles are even in that position still to be first in the division. But it is what it is. It's probably going to be short-lived, though, considering the Eagles' upcoming schedule. They have the Steelers next and then the Ravens after that. I think the Eagles can probably be pretty competitive in the game against the Steelers. They're actually going to be coming off of 14 days rest with the whole COVID situation with the Titans because they had to get their game postponed. So it could go either way there. The Steelers could be more rested and more ready to go because they had the 14 days off, or they could technically come out sluggish and the Eagles could take advantage of it. I don't know. Hopefully the Eagles get a little bit more healthy in the upcoming week, but we'll see how that goes. So let me get right into the first Monday Night Football game. Kansas City versus New England. This game, I'm probably going to touch on New England the most here because Kansas City in the end just did what they always do. So let me start off with some points on New England that I noticed throughout the game. The Pats really made Pat work. I mean, they made him work for everything. Bill Belichick calling a fantastic game, pretty much like always. It never fails. This man is the best defensive mind probably in the history of football. So he made Patrick Mahomes work for everything that Kansas City earned in that game. And one of the things that, and I was watching the broadcast, and I'm actually glad that Tony Romo pointed it out for me. Appreciate that. Because I don't know if I would even notice it in the first place. But New England did something very, very interesting on defense, especially when Mahomes got into the red zone. They actually ended up just rushing three linemen and dropping two defenders into the curl flat areas. And so they were pretty much responsible for the curl flat area, but they were also had the responsibility of kind of spying on Mahomes on both sides. Because Mahomes, like if you watch pretty much any Kansas City game, as soon as Kansas City and Mahomes get into the red zone, this man will roll out, he'll go side to side, he'll spin back on you, just to kind of scramble around and make a play happen. He finds windows to throw into whenever he's moving like that. And so New England, you know, has been noticing that obviously on film and said, you know, we're gonna stop that. So that's what those two spies were for on the pass defense. And it kept Patrick Mahomes inside the pocket in the red zone. So where he had to be basically just a statue and keep standing there until something happened. But that back, you know, that secondary of the Patriots is so good. And once the field gets condensed like that in the red zone, it's tough to pass on the Pats. So they did a really good job. That was great game planning. Film review from, obviously, Bill Belichick, best in the business. So on that drive specifically, when Tony Romo, you know, pointed it out, they actually Pat Mahomes kind of stalled because they threw an incompletion on that one pass where he said it. And then the only reason they really even capitalized on that drive was just a really, really creative call from Andy Reid, where they did a reverse fake jet sweep to Tyreek Hill, who took it because he's the fastest guy in the NFL, took it to the pylon, and it was barely a touchdown, but they got it done because Andy Reid's just an unbelievable play caller and play designer in general. But back to some points on New England, I think a lot of people, if you look at the stat sheet on this one, you're going to say, oh, you know, Brian Hoyer came in, he kind of blew it, which I completely agree with. And then you're going to say, you know, Stidham came in, he kind of blew it too. But I'd back off that narrative for a second, just because Stidham, his first interception that he threw was not his fault. He throws the ball to Edelman. It goes straight through Edelman's hands. It was just one of those lapses in focus there for Edelman. And it goes straight to Tyrann Mathieu, who's making the play, and he goes for a pick six. And then later in the game, when Stidham throws another interception, I mean, it's late. It's basically garbage time. Stidham's just trying to make something happen, and he throws a pick. It's going to happen. He's young. He's going to grow. He's going to take his lumps early. I still think he's going to be an okay quarterback. I don't think anybody should hit the panic button on him as a developmental QB. So that's where I stand on Stidham for the time being. Just some points on Brian Hoyer to start the game. He actually didn't start the game off too bad. He was making some pretty good decisions, pretty good passes. He was pretty accurate. It's just, I think it's the combination of him being like a backup and him just not having that game, like, I don't know, feel, because he just hadn't started in so long in the NFL. And I think his awareness levels were a little low, like especially on that strip sack in the red zone. You just can't take that strip sack and give the ball back to Kansas City in that area, because, I mean, obviously it's 3 points at the very least for the Pats, and they make it a ball game, and it should have been tied up 6-6 right there at the very least, like I said. So you just can't do those type of things when you come in as a backup. And Belichick eventually, after the interception, just had enough of it and just wanted to see what Stidham had. So I don't blame him there, but that's kind of how that game went. I mean, kind of like I alluded to earlier, basically the only way, or the main reason Kansas City came away with this win was because they were just so creative on offense and they played smart. They played where they... It was rare for them to make a stupid decision. Pat Mahomes hasn't made very many bad decisions in pretty much all the games this season. But like I said, and kind of think that was week two when Kansas City was playing the Chargers. It was the same type of thing where the Chargers were just containing Mahomes, where they weren't letting him get anything crazy deep downfield. They didn't even want him to get into a rhythm like that. So they were able to contain him, but Mahomes was just smart enough and mature enough at this point, which is scary because a mature Mahomes doesn't make mistakes very often. The one mistake that he almost made, or really did make, was the strip sack fumble slash interception that should have been called an interception, but they called him, you know, down or in the grass or whatever, which was a really weird call by the refs. But that's football. Crazy stuff's going to happen like that. Belichick was very upset with that call, and I don't blame him at all because that was a game-changing play. But in the end, like I said, Kansas City just made the smart plays. Creative game planning and play calling from Andy Reid got it done for them. So the next game that I watched was Green Bay versus Falcons. That was the late Monday Night Football game. And really, I'm going to start with the Falcons here, but there's really not too much to say here other than the fact that, as I alluded to earlier, the Falcons defense is competing very hard to be just as bad, if not worse, than the Dallas Cowboys defense this year. They're like neck and neck with who can play the worst on defense. And I don't want to blame the Falcons as much as the Cowboys at this point, because the Falcons have just been just ravaged with injuries this year. I mean, even in the game, like just watching it, players are going down left and right. They're without, I mean, Ricardo Allen and Keanu Neal and just AJ Terrell. Like pretty much their entire secondary is out right now. And there was miscommunication throughout the whole game. And that bad man Aaron Rodgers, shout out to Stephen A. Smith. He knew what he was talking about when he started that. Because that man took advantage of every single second of it. I mean, Aaron Rodgers came in and just continued his MVP campaign more than anything. I mean, they're without Davante Adams, his number one. They're without Alan Lazard, his number two wide receiver. And the only healthy wide receiver that really got any snaps all of the season, Marquez Valdez-Scantling. I mean, he's the only healthy one out there. And Roger, it didn't matter to Rodgers. He got it done. I mean, he just threw to his tight ends and running backs pretty much the entire game. That game plan from Matt LaFleur was unbelievable. Like, I mean, obviously, it helped playing the Falcons because they were nowhere to be found on defense. Literally, people were just running around wide open. But it didn't really matter because Rodgers was hitting everybody on the money, just hitting them right in the numbers. But, I mean, like, I was talking to my buddy before. My buddy plays Daily Fantasy. And he was asking me, he was like, you know, thoughts on the games tonight for Monday Night Football. And I was telling him, I know Rodgers has, you know, his top two receivers out, but he's got to throw to somebody. I said, so, you know, play those running backs, play the tight ends. He's been throwing to the tight ends more often than he has in the past. And in this game, Robert Tonyan had himself a game. 3 touchdowns. It was unbelievable. Aaron Jones is still showing out. I mean, catching balls out of the backfield like he has done in the past and just running the ball. I mean, he must have averaged 5 yards per carry on this night. And even Jamal Williams, man, I knew he could catch the ball out of the backfield, but this dude was going all out on wide receiver routes and catching the ball 30 yards down the field and taking hits, like impact hits. As soon as the ball gets there, he gets hit by a defender and just holding onto the ball. Like, you don't see that from every running back. It was really, really impressive to watch. And like I said, that Packers offense is going to be super, super scary, especially when Davante Adams gets back. I don't know if Lazard will come back for this year. He may if they make like a decent playoff run, which I expect them to, actually, because he had his core muscle injury, which actually was something DeSean Jackson dealt with last year after week 2. And DeSean should have gotten the surgery back then, and he would have been ready to go in the playoff game that the Eagles played in against Seattle last year. So it was very smart of Alan Lazard to go ahead and get the surgery, not try to rehab it and fix it. It could have been just the severity, or it could have been, you know, the choice, but it was smart of him to go ahead and get that surgery and possibly have a chance of coming back for the season. And if that's the case, the Packers are going to be, you know, a team that they're just going to be scary for pretty much every team in the NFC. And, man, another point on the Packers, and basically just Rodgers in particular, especially with the 3 games that I picked to watch this week, man, it's just so frustrating to watch my team, the Eagles, and Carson Wentz on Sunday Night Football absolutely struggle with just getting the ball down the field. I mean, they have to do everything so methodically. I mean, I'm excited for 4-yard passes and completions. It's pretty sad at this point, but that's where we're at with how injured we are, and Carson's not playing the best of his career right now. He showed some flashes on Sunday that made me, you know, a little bit more confident that he's coming back around, but it was just frustrating to watch that and just how hard it is to get the ball down the field for the Eagles and even get 3 points, let alone a touchdown. And then on Monday night, just watch Aaron Rodgers. He's just such a natural thrower of the football, and he's just out there just tossing it around and just hitting people in stride perfectly. Like, it really is just, he's just so impressive. And I still think, you know, other than the fact that Mahomes has come in here in the last few years, I still think Aaron Rodgers is the greatest quarterback I've ever seen play. He's just so good at every aspect. I mean, he can scramble, he can run. I know this has turned into like an Aaron Rodgers love fest lately on this podcast, and I kind of apologize for that. But, you know, it is what it is. That's where we're at right now, and that's just how I feel. So I think I'm going to end it there. It's kind of a bit of a short one this week. But, yeah, just follow us on iTestTakes on Twitter and on Instagram. And we appreciate you watching. And I hope everybody enjoys this upcoming week 5. Hopefully everybody's team wins. You know, that can't really happen. But, you know, I'll say that anyways. Just everybody's teams have good luck. But, yeah, I'll see you guys later. Thank you for watching.